Hello and welcome to our lecture on Rh incompatibility causing erythroblastosis fetalis. We'll start off by discussing what makes blood groups Rh incompatible, then we'll move on and cover the pathogenesis and clinical features seen in this condition, and finally we'll finish off by discussing the diagnostic tests and treatment options for these patients. So let's get started. Right, so erythroblastosis fetalis can result from Rh incompatibility between the mother and her fetus. And this incompatibility can develop when a woman with an Rh negative blood is impregnated with a man with Rh positive blood, and then she goes on to have a fetus with Rh positive blood. To illustrate, let's say we have a pregnant mother with Rh negative blood on the left, and her fetus with Rh positive blood on the right. This means that Rh antigens are not present on the surface of mother's red blood cells. And if you can remember from our video on blood groups, individuals with Rh negative blood do not have antibodies to Rh antigens present in the serum by birth. In order for them to develop these antibodies, which are called anti-D antibodies, they have to first get sensitized. This can happen at any point throughout their life, should they ever require blood transfusion, or become pregnant, or experience any other event that introduces Rh positive blood into their system. Their immune system will treat the Rh antigens on those red cells as foreign, and mount an immune reaction against them, which will produce anti-D antibodies. Once these antibodies are produced, they will stay present in the circulation throughout the rest of their lives. And if in the future they're exposed to Rh-positive blood again, the anti-D antibodies will go on and attack all the Rh-positive red cells, eventually leading to hemolysis. So now that we know all this, let's go back and see how this relates to erythroblastosis fetalis. In a pregnant mother, placenta normally acts as a barrier and prevents the mixing of blood between the mother and her fetus. This in our case can ensure that the fetus's blood, which is Rh positive, will not enter the mother's circulation, so no anti-D antibodies will be produced. However, if at any point during pregnancy, there is mixing of blood, maybe due to fetal-maternal hemorrhage, a small number of fetal red blood cells can enter the maternal circulation, and from what we know already, presence of Rh-positive red cells in Rh-negative individuals will trigger an immune response which will produce anti-D antibodies. These anti-D antibodies are IgG in nature, and remember that IgG antibodies can cross the placenta. This still usually does not affect the first baby, because by the time these antibodies are produced, the baby has already been delivered or is about to be delivered. However, if the same mother gets pregnant again with a fetus with Rh-positive blood, the anti-D antibodies present in the mother's circulation will now cross the placenta and attack the Rh-positive red cells of the fetus, eventually leading to hemolysis. An important point I want to emphasize here is that erythroblastosis fetalis does not usually occur in the first pregnancy. It is seen more frequently in subsequent pregnancies. Let's look at some causes that can introduce Rh-positive blood into a patient with Rh-negative blood. Fetal-maternal hemorrhage is an umbrella term that refers to a number of causes that can lead to the entry of fetal blood into the maternal circulation during pregnancy. It can occur during labor, transplacental hemorrhage, childbirth, or abortion. Obstetric diagnostic procedures performed by the physician can also sometimes be the reason. If the mother ever had any incompatible blood transfusion in the past that exposed her to Rh-positive blood, then anti-D antibodies are likely to be present in her serum. Let's now look at some of the clinical features seen in this condition. Due to hemolysis, hemoglobin molecules contained in the red blood cells are released into the circulation. Hemoglobin then gets converted into heme and globin. Heme is broken down into protoporphyrin and iron, and globin, being a protein, is further broken down into amino acids. Protoporphyrin then gets converted into unconjugated bilirubin, which in turn is conjugated by the liver so it can be excreted out of the body by the kidneys. In erythroblastosis fetalis, since we've got a lot of antibodies that are hemolyzing the red blood cells, it can lead to anemia because the red blood cells carry oxygen to the tissues. Destroying them will reduce the total amount of oxygen that is being delivered. Furthermore, hemolysis will also increase the amount of hemoglobin that is being recycled, which will indirectly increase the unconjugated bilirubin levels. High unconjugated bilirubin levels are toxic and can lead to jaundice, which can be visualized by yellowish discoloration of the skin and the eyes of the baby once it's delivered. Unconjugated bilirubin is also lipid soluble, so it can cross the blood-brain barrier and can deposit in the brain, especially in the basal ganglia. This can result in a condition called kernicterus. Due to an increase in the demand for red blood cells, extramedullary hematopoiesis kicks in, and this means that the production of red blood cells are taking place outside the bone marrow. The liver and the spleen are the main sites for this, and this accounts for their enlargement, known as hepatosplenomegaly. One of the most severe clinical presentations of erythroblastosis fetalis that is worth mentioning is Hydrops Fetalis. Hydrops Fetalis is when large volumes of fluid build up in the fetus's tissues and organs. Let's go through a flowchart to understand this condition better. So the fetus in Hydrops Fetalis will have severe anemia. This will cause extramedullary hematopoiesis to kick in, and this means that the liver and the spleen are also producing red blood cells. As a result, the normal functions of the liver are impaired, such as producing albumin, which is a protein that is responsible for maintaining the oncotic pressure and keeping the fluid inside the blood vessels. Low albumin levels can decrease the total oncotic pressure, which can cause the fluid to leak out of the blood vessels and accumulate in the tissues, resulting in generalized edema. Let's see what's going on in the heart in this condition. So like we said earlier, due to severe anemia, tissues in the body are not receiving enough oxygen to function normally. To compensate for this, the heart tries to pump out more and more blood each time, thinking that it will meet the tissue's oxygen demand. But unfortunately, it cannot keep up and eventually fails because there are fewer red cells present in the circulation to transport oxygen. We call this condition high output heart failure, and this in turn can increase the central venous pressure. Increased central venous pressure along with decreased oncotic pressure results in the leakage of massive amount of fluid from the blood vessels. So all in all, in Hydrops Fetalis, there is generalized edema, ascites, which is abnormal buildup of fluid in the abdominal region, and the backup of blood into the pulmonary veins due to heart failure can cause pulmonary edema, which can result in respiratory distress. All of these events can ultimately lead to the death of the fetus in utero. Here is a picture of a baby who was suffering from Hydrops Fetalis. To diagnose Rh incompatibility causing erythroblastosis fetalis, you can draw blood to find decreased hemoglobin and hematocrit levels and increased reticulocyte count in the baby. Reticulocytes are basically immature red blood cells, so if a lot of red blood cells are getting destroyed in the body, then in an attempt to compensate for their losses, the bone marrow will try to produce as many red blood cells as possible, and in doing so it will pump out immature red blood cells as well, which can be detected on a blood test. And like we mentioned earlier, unconjugated bilirubin levels will also be increased. This is due to the increase in recycling of hemoglobin from hemolysis. Maternal blood and Rh typing can be performed during a prenatal visit to check for Rh negative blood and detect for any anti-D antibodies in the mother's circulation. Anti-D antibodies can be detected by indirect Coombs test. I've made a separate video on Coombs test in which I discuss the indirect and direct Coombs test and their clinical significance. I recommend watching it if you have any doubts about this test. Treating erythroblastosis fetalis involves intrauterine exchange transfusion. In this, blood is transfused to the fetus while it's still in utero. Phototherapy can also be performed where you would keep the baby under UV light. UV light exposure converts the unconjugated bilirubin into its conjugated form, which is usually safe and water soluble, so it can be easily excreted by the kidneys. As for prevention, Rogam can be administered to mothers with Rh negative blood to prevent them from becoming sensitized to Rh positive blood. This is an anti-D prophylaxis that comes in contact with Rh-positive red cells that may enter the maternal circulation during labor or childbirth. It then binds to those Rh antigens present on those cells and blocks them. This prevents the mother's immune system from becoming sensitized and producing anti-D antibodies. A physician would ideally administer Rogam to Rh-negative mothers who are carrying Rh-positive baby towards the end of the pregnancy. One thing to note is that Rogam is only administered to those who are not yet sensitized. If the mother has already been sensitized, which means that she has been exposed to Rh-positive blood in the past, this mode of prevention won't help as anti-D antibodies are already present in her serum. So that's all for Rh incompatibility causing erythroblastosis fetalis. I really hope everything made sense. If you found this video helpful, please give it a like, and if you have any questions, please leave them in the comments section below. I'll try to get back to you as soon as I can. And do consider subscribing to our channel. Until next time.